Always put into words the problems, issues, challenges people are trying to get away from and the opportunities or positive place they're trying to ultimately get closer to. Convert your subscription offer to membership. Whenever you possibly can, make people feel like they're members. I mean, I don't know if Richard does it here, but the VIP section, it has more of an affinity. You feel more special. If your best buyers were called members of your platinum or your gold, or again, I don't know what your Chinese or Japanese language phrases might be that are, you know, the highest level of distinction, pinnacle. But people, I mean, it's human nature. You feel, you want to feel special. I carry a platinum American Express card. And I'm this far away from spending so much money that I can have a black one. Now, that's the dumbest thing in the world because you got to pay $2,500 a year for the privilege of carrying it. But it's a great distinction. We all want to feel special. We want to feel beyond everybody else. If there are categories of your buyers you can make feel special, create clubs, membership organizations where they are honored, distinguished, get preferential access, early alerts of new products, discounts, chances to meet the manufacturer, the designer, chances to go out with you on golf trips or movie trips or just whatever. Make us feel special and we'll be bonded to you for life. Use department store pricing. Remember I said that $9.95 outpulls 10? Well, it usually does. Not always, but test it. That extra nickel could be costing you 40% of the sales you could be getting. We don't know why. It doesn't matter why. All that matters is that it's a fact. When you test $9.95 against 10, $9.95 will win out 90% of the time by 2-3 times over. I don't know why. Just test it, and you might be very humbled that your price may be psychologically a deterrent. We saw one time a car dealer was trying to sell a car for $7,770. Wouldn't sell. He raised it to like $9,999, and he sold it the next day. Don't ask why. There's a lot of psychological elements that I don't really clearly understand. I just know they work, and you have to see if you can harness them. Make your special offer believable. Otherwise, it will not succeed. Credibility is, you know, someone taught me this long ago, and it changed my life. I was a fast and loose young Turk. You know what young Turk means? It means like a young, cocky, arrogant, you know, is just a conceited person when I started out. And I cut corners, and it came back and haunted me. And a very dear mentor took me by the side early in my life and changed my life by saying, son, you can lose all your money and get it back, but once you lose your integrity, you'll never get it back. Your integrity is the most priceless commodity, your ethics, your integrity. Don't compromise it for anything. Don't lower yourself, even if your competitors are dastardly and nasty. Don't take advantage of clients. Don't take advantage even of your employees. Do the right thing. It comes back and rewards you in ways you'll never imagine. Offer installment payments, we already talked about that. Add additional elements to your mailing package. Those people who use mailing packages, direct mail, normally the more pieces you put in, the more it engages the reader. A regular sales letter, a short brochure, maybe what we call a lift letter, a little small monarch-sized piece of paper folded over that summarizes the offer. We've even seen the addition of tokens, little self-sticky, like little decals that you put on the card when you send back an order, double response. I don't know, because I don't know what you all do, but test adding different useful components that engage the buyer more. The longer they're engaged, the more invested they are. The more invested they are, the more inclined they are to buy. Think about that. More time they spend, the more time they buy. We have a series of 90-minute to 3-hour recorded presentations that we play for teleconference groups in the States, and we track, and people who stay on for the duration have about 7 times the probability of buying as people that, you know, only stay on for half the, I mean, just logic. Use that awareness, those connections to your advantage. Use long copy. Tell the complete story. There's an argument in the States. Well, you know, long copy is hard to read. The key is you tell the most complete story you need to for the job you're trying to do. In other words, if you're selling Mercedes automobiles and everybody in your country knows the price of a Mercedes and you have no advantage on it, you don't have to elaborate a lot. But if you're selling something very unique and you're distinguishing yourself, you want to tell the whole story. And if it's going to benefit or impact people's lives at a really great level, you want to tell the most complete story possible, adhering to all those template formulas I gave you. Remember? This makes sense. We're almost done. Gets a little daunting on the end of the second day, but this makes sense? Everybody? Yes? Yes? Okay. Repeat your entire offer in the brochure as well as the letter. I already told you the purpose of a brochure. Pay attention to your mailing list. They're the most important element in your mailing campaign. Most people don't realize it. The media you use is infinitely more important than the message, believe it or not. If you get a high predisposed, a highly probable audience, they're going to buy more in spite than because. We used to be, every time we found people who had terrible ads, I used to be in the business opportunity field. I ran Entrepreneur Magazine years and years ago. And we wanted always to grow our subscriber base. And we would look for lists. First thing we'd look for lists of other people who bought business opportunity. Then we'd look for lists of other people who bought investment, because investment meant trading and options and fast, quick profit, which is another form of business opportunity. Then we looked for people who inquired about franchises. But we looked for people who bought information about investing in real estate. But when we looked at those lists, the first thing we did was we wanted to see the marketing pieces that created those lists. The better the marketing piece, the worse the list performed. The worse the marketing piece, the better the list will perform, because the bad marketers were finding people who were responding in spite, not because of the marketing. Those people were hardcore, massively responsive people who wanted to learn everything they could about as many things as they could about making money. And so use logic. Try to figure who has the list of people you want to reach more than anything. Even if it's not available for rent, maybe you can do a joint venture, a swap, a barter, trade your list for theirs. Maybe you can do an endorsement. But the media you access is going to have much more to do with your success than your great marketing. In other words, if you write great marketing, let's say you sell industrial equipment and your average piece of equipment machinery is $200,000 US. You might write the greatest lead generating letter based on what I said. You might come up with the greatest sales presentation, but if you send that letter to a bunch of people who live in homes outside of Tokyo, the odds of finding somebody who wants to buy it is just luck. You'd be much better off sending it to a list of people who own businesses and industries that would be prospects for you, and sending it to people within those businesses who are the buying influence, the decision maker. That's going to improve your prospects about 100 times over. Does that make sense? Yes? Do make your letters look and feel like real letters. Don't cut corners. Don't use ugly colored paper. Make it look like a personal, important, private, human, individualized, thought-based communication from one party to another. Use special offers to your client list. You can make preferential, special, advanced, priority, VIP offers to your list to make them feel special. A lot of times we have clients, and particularly if our clients have cash flow problems, will pre-announce new products or services or opportunities to our list and let them reserve it in advance with full payment and a discount, or a payment for, to hold it, and like a good faith deposit. And sometimes we'll get millions of dollars up front by making our clients feel special. But do that. Remail profitable lists immediately. I already talked about that. Use short words, short sentences, short paragraphs. I don't know Chinese and Japanese language, but I know that one of the biggest mistakes most people make in business trying to communicate marketing, long paragraphs. The way most of us talk, short paragraphs. The way most of us talk, and again, I don't care that I don't know Japanese or Chinese, it's no different than ours. There are a lot of statements that are fragments. If you talked to me for an hour and I recorded it and transcribed it, there'd be a bunch of broken sentences and fragments and one-word statements. And you got to be able to try to incorporate the same way people talk into your letters. And you need to be able to pick up one thing which is very evident in the Japanese and Chinese language, and it's pretty evident in ours, that's inflection, emotion. You do that with underlining. You do it with exclamation marks. In our language, I don't know what you do with your characters. You do it with big bold. You do it with oversized letters. You do it with color accentuation. When you're converting what you'd normally say into written words, you got to be able to also convert emotion. Does that make sense? Most people don't look at it like that. It's very critical. Indent your paragraphs again. I don't know what this means in Japanese and Chinese, but in English language, if you indent, move the paragraph, start it about a quarter of an inch over, it's easier on the eyes to read, and it makes it easier for people to do the flow and continue reading it. I don't know what it means in Japanese and Chinese, but figure out if there's an application and then make that application. If not, I apologize. Do underline important phrases and words, or whatever the equivalent is in your language. Make it special. Don't ever write a letter or an email or a website landing page with a letter from the president or the CEO or the managing director without a PS at the end. Every photograph should have a caption. Man, this is so important. Whether it's your catalogs, your brochures, your website, when people put pictures, when people put graphs, when people put charts, they put an enormous burden on the reader to try to figure out what in the world it means and what the conclusion is. It's not fair to the reader. It's your obligation, now that you know how to write great copy, great headlines, to put captions, words below it that summarize the importance. Like, you can see this chart shows that 10 times as many people using our product lost weight as any other one. Or you can see this picture of the complexion after only 3 days is 50% clear and more youth-like than it was on Monday. But don't expect the reader to figure anything out. When you do that, you're losing leverage. Make sense? Always put into words the problems, issues, challenges people are trying to get away from, and the opportunities or positive place they're trying to ultimately get closer to. This is like the strategy of preeminence we talked about, but it's just putting it in one more. I'm trying to layer it so it impacts all of you in many different ways. Always use sequential marketing. Think, well, this is Chinese water torture. The dot, dot, dot till it finally works. Well, the same thing. Tonight when we do our homework, there's going to be people who should be getting a document that explains sequential marketing. Hopefully when they report tomorrow their impressions, those of you who, because you're not going to get it the Chinese and the Japanese because the translation was going to be too difficult, but you'll be able to listen and gain from it. Very important. Harness the 80-20 rule to maximum advantage. 80-20 works everywhere. 80% of your profit comes from 20% of your clients. 80% of your frustration comes from 20% of your buyers. 80% of your efforts produce only 20%, and 20% of your efforts produce 80%. Figure out what they are and leverage those and reduce the less productive, the less successful, the less positive things in your life. It's so easy once you understand this. All you have to do is do some data analysis and some self-analysis of your time, your efforts, your business, it'll produce incredible breakthroughs for you. Figure out where you are beatable and change things right now. Remember I said you want to be unbeatable? Figure out why your offers or propositions are resistible and correct the situation so you make them irresistible. Know every tangible and intangible objective, reservation, concern, apprehension that a prospective buyer could either say or think or feel before you ever have the first contact with that prospect. And that contact can be with an ad, with a sales call, with a telemarketing, with a letter, with a website. Because if you know those, you can incorporate those right into your proposition and you can diffuse or overcome them right there and then, thus reducing the barrier to entry, the hurdle rate. Ask for referrals. Re-review those 93 ways, pick five, start testing them and seeing what a profound and significant difference it makes in your business. Truly become their most trusted advisor. Shop your competition frequently, and this is multifaceted. If they're big, go to their stores. If they have telemarketers, call in and let them try to sell you. If they've got retail, go to their retail stores. Go to their websites. Shop everybody around the world. Also, constantly try to hire your competitors' people because the interviewing process is such a revealing source of ethical intelligence gathering. You can learn about their beliefs, their philosophies, their selling approach. It's just amazing, and hopefully you will hire quality people if your ethics are right. But if you don't, you're going to learn so much. Doesn't that make sense? It's exciting, isn't it? Pardon? And protect yours, of course. Meet your competitors' clients. Go to them and say, I mean, I'd call them and say, you know, I'm Jay Abraham. I run Abraham Industries. You obviously don't buy from us. You buy from that darn Akiro who's got the Akiro Intergalactic Corporation. And I'm not trying to sell you, but I want to know, can you be honest with me? Tell me what they do, what they give you. What is it about them that makes you want to favor them without us? Because I want to make us better. We may never have your business, but I really want to do everything we can to make our company not just as good, but better, give more value, give more benefit, have more advantage and appeal to people like you. And again, your answers may never get me your business, but it might help me get other people's business that we can contribute to. And that kind of approach does three things. Most of them will answer you and give you ideas. Half of them will be so impressed with your sincerity and your humility, they'll give you a shot at getting their business. No, it's great intelligence gathering. Get trained in consultative selling. Okay, remember the three types of entrepreneurs? People who make things happen. People who watch things happen. People who things keep happening to. Hopefully, we've gotten all of you at least into this group. Now we got to get you to the top of the group, and we got to accelerate and magnify the number of things you do, the impact of the things you do, and the sustaining ability to keep doing things and have them go work more for you. One of the keys to business building Jay Abraham style is you're always going to have to work, but the more strategic you become, the more your business will work hard for you instead of you having to work hard for it. That's what you're trying to move to. That's where it becomes an asset people will prize. What do you think? Spike? Pardon? Wrap it up? Okay, so here's what we're going to do. Did you find out the answer to that question? Pardon? Why don't you tell me, excuse me one second. That's right. We want to wrap it up, but we're going to do some things. Those of you who speak English are going to stay here for 45 minutes, and you're going to start reading some homework assignments we're going to distribute. I have about 10 different interviews, reports, treatises that I or my colleagues or us together have done that give you different parts of this puzzle. And tomorrow we're going to report on it, but we've divided them equally so each of you will get one or two to read tonight to talk to the group about. Because the translation is really tough, we've picked two universal, the best two, that we think have the most benefit for the Chinese and the Japanese business people, and we're going to ask them to go into the corner here and go into the corner there, and the translators are going to try to read them and interpret them for you. So that's what you do for a half an hour. Now we're going to review the homework. What else did we say we wanted them to do for tomorrow, Spike? Okay, tonight, this is what you're going to do in the room. Tonight, we want you to read the approximately 10 pages that are all about the $37 million headlines, because it'll explain to you, it describes the actual foundations of how you construct and the psychology of 37 different headlines. It'll give you one more layer of understanding. What else did we say? Yeah, I said something else. Hold on. Okay, two more things. I want you to work on 10 more headline variations, like five each, okay, and bring the ones you think are the best with you tomorrow. And I want you to start thinking, you don't have to write it down, but start thinking about how many different ways you could put risk reversal, partial risk reversal, complete risk reversal, better than complete risk reversal into your business. So you're going to stay here for 45 minutes and read as many of the documents as we give you, and you're each going to get one, I think. A couple you're going to get a double one because they are extensions of the same thing. The Chinese are going to go over there and be read to, two of them. The Japanese are going to be read to, two of them. Take lots of notes, because tomorrow you're going to discuss what you got out of these. When you go home tonight, everyone's going to do the 37 headlines. They're going to do 10 more headlines from the 100 greatest and five examples each. And you're going to think about risk reversal. Tomorrow at 9 a.m., Spike will work through with you your impressions till 9:45 or so. I will come back. Just so you know, you have been so good that we are so ahead of our plan. We're going to have a lot of fun tomorrow, aren't we? We're going to do a little bit on barter. We're going to do a lot on strategic alliances. And then probably right after lunch, we're going to start building out your integrated, individualized marketing game plan. And we'll probably spend a couple hours. We won't finish it, but we'll get you so well started that you'll know what you're doing. And then, time allowing, because we have to be out of here at a certain time tomorrow, I'm going to entertain with Spike on stage questions, issues, challenges, anything you want to talk about, for an hour or so, okay? So that's tomorrow. Make sense? Any questions? Cool. Okay. You guys have a good evening. Japanese there, Chinese there, English stay here. Distribute all the reports, everybody. It'll take a couple minutes. And enjoy your evening. Thank you.